Good afternoon, friends. Namaskar, and good to see you after a break. Welcome to this weekly press briefing. After my briefing, we will have a special briefing on the Prime Minister's visit to Sweden and UK. And I will have three joint secretaries who will be coming at around 4 o'clock. Before we move to the Q&A session, I have one small announcement to make. And this is regarding an initiative which we launched on 22nd of March in Hyderabad. And the name of the initiative was Videsh Aaya Pradesh Ke Dwar. Now, this is an engagement and initiative to connect with the regional media. We started this with Hyderabad because we thought that it is a hub of regional media. And the objective is very simple, to connect to the people at the grassroots level, to engage directly with the media, the regional media who do not get a chance to be in Delhi. And we intend to take this initiative to different cities across India and engage directly with the regional media which is based out of Delhi. And at that launch, I agreed that at the beginning of every press briefing, weekly press briefing which I do, I will take one question from the regional media and they will share their questions on WhatsApp. So today I am going to start with the first question which has been posed to me by Sushil from Hyderabad. And he has asked about the welfare of a missing Indian family in California. I think some of you might have heard about it. And I want to respond that External Affairs Minister was very quick to take note of this incident. Since then, our consulate, they are maintaining contact with the family members of the missing people. Basically, it's a family of four people. Sandeep Thottia Pilli, his wife Soumya, and his two children. And they have been missing since 6th April. We are in touch with the State Police Department, and we are also in touch with the Highway Patrol. And we are trying our best to locate the whereabouts of this missing family. So this was the first question from the regional media. Now I open the floor to questions. Vinita.
Ravish, India and China recently had discussions on the nuclear suppliers group. Can you just give us some idea on, is there any movement forward on the discussion that happened there?
Are you referring to the meeting which took place recently? In fact, Vinita, after that we had issued a press release. I can only share at this stage that both at the working level and also at different interactions which we have, the issues which are of concern to us, they are taken up and raised with the Chinese side. There are discussions which we have with the Chinese side on all matters which are of interest to us. Parikshit?
Sir, just an update on the request that we had sent for Nirav Modi. There is no word from Hong Kong as yet, but any kind of exchange of documents or evidence or any update that you may have on our request?
Parikshit, you may be aware about the written reply submitted by our Minister of State in the Parliament. And that was the time when we shared that Nirav Modi is in Hong Kong. I can only add to that by saying that we have requested the Hong Kong authorities to surrender Nirav Modi. Actually, there is an agreement between India and Hong Kong. And the agreement is for the surrender of fugitive offenders. This was signed between India and Hong Kong in 1997. Our mission in Hong Kong has informed that the Department of Justice are still examining a request for the provisional order of arrest of Nirav Modi. And we are still awaiting a response from their side. Akhilesh ji. जैसा कि मैंने कहा कि हमारे जो विदेश राज्य मंत्री हैं उन्होंने इस मामले में एक लिखित बयान दिया था पार्लियामेंट में और इस समय मैं ये बता सकता हूं कि हमने हांगकांग अथॉरिटीज़ के साथ रिक्वेस्ट किया है नीरव मोदी को सरेंडर करने के लिए एक हमारी अग्रीमेंट है इंडिया और हांगकांग के बीच में जो सरेंडर ऑफ फ्यूजिटिव ऑफेंडर्स के नाम से है और ये 1997 में हमने साइन की थी. हमारा जो मिशन है कॉन्सुलेट है हांगकांग में, उन्होंने डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ जस्टिस जो है हांगकांग का उनको बताया है और वो हमारा जो ये रिक्वेस्ट है एग्जामिन कर रहे हैं. हमारा जो रिक्वेस्ट है फॉर प्रोविजनल ऑर्डर ऑफ अरेस्ट ऑफ नीरव मोदी उसको एग्जामिन कर रहे हैं और जैसे ही हमारे पास कुछ जानकारी होगी इसके बारे में हम आपको बताएंगे. अखिलेश जी,
सर, देयर आर रिपोर्ट्स दैट इन सीरिया केमिकल वेपन्स हैड बीन यूज्ड, though there is denial from Syrian government side also. So what is your input about it and what is your reaction about it?
We have seen reports about the alleged use of chemical weapons in Douma, Syrian Arab Republic. Any use of chemical weapons anywhere, at any time, by anybody, under any circumstances, is in complete disregard of humanity and is reprehensible and contrary to provisions of the Chemical Weapons Convention, as well as accepted international norms. The perpetrators of such abhorrent acts must be held accountable. Mukesh ji.
Sir, I would draw your attention to a media report about the death of a Belgian national in mysterious circumstances 2 years ago. When his body reached his home, it was found that his kidney, his heart, and other parts of important organs were missing. The murder trial was resumed, and I came to know that they have 3 times requested Indian government to cooperate, but cooperation is not, they are still awaiting your response. What is your comment, and would you allow their investigators to come here and investigate the murder?
Mukesh ji, I think let me highlight that this is a law and order matter, you see, which is being handled by the state government. And I think this incident took place, if I'm not mistaken, in the state of Gujarat. We have seen press reports. We have also been approached by the Belgian authorities in this regard, as you rightly mentioned. We are extending all possible help. You see, the help has to be in terms of conducting an investigation. MEA can only facilitate the channel between the Belgian government and the law enforcement authorities in Gujarat. We do await the conclusion of the investigation. And as I mentioned that from our perspective, from MEA perspective, whatever help is required, I think we are extending all possible help. Siddhant.
So we saw a release from the Kremlin regarding talks between Prime Minister Narendra Modi and the Russian President. What transpired? Can you give us a readout or something?
Siddhant, you just said that you have already seen a release between.
It wasn't detail, not in detail.
That is at this stage. Side. At this stage, that is what I can share. I think as is mentioned in the release by Kremlin today, it says that all matters of mutual interest, they have been discussed. And at this stage, I don't have any further details. You know, if I have, then we will share it on the group.
When was the talk?
This took place yesterday. I think the telephonic conversation took place yesterday on 11th. And 11th?
In the night.
11th. Yes. Night, morning. So it took place on the 11th. Huh. Ranjit ji.
Is the NSA visiting China these days or is in China right now?
At this point of time, I have no information about the visit. Normally, if a visit is to be announced, we do that in this forum or we will announce it through our WhatsApp group. But if the visit is taking place, we will let you know. Suhasini.
My apologies. I believe I missed the question on Nirav Modi, but I did want to ask as a follow-up, have we sent similar inquiries and a request for an arrest to the U.S. authorities for Mr. Mehul Choksi? I know we don't have the extradition treaty, but even so, given our friendly ties, have we asked the United States for any kind of assistance on the investigation?
Suhasini, you know, I mean, I have mentioned from this forum in the past that MEA comes into the picture where the location of the fugitive is ascertained, you know. informed by the edited hai usme se kam 150 countries mein hamare high level engagement hue hain iska matlab ye hai ki minister and above ki visit hui hai jahan tak meri jankari hai ki 25 se 30 countries aise the jisme hamara koi engagement nahi hua hai kafi saalon se aur ye hamara effort tha ki jitne bhi countries bache hue hain उन कंट्रीज़ को हम किसी हाई लेवल विज़िट से मिनिस्ट्रियल लेवल विज़िट हो या जो भी हो उससे हम उसको उसमें टच में आए और उसी के अंतर्गत आपने शायद देखा होगा कि जो हमारे मंत्रीगण हैं और जो हाई लेवल ऑफिशियल्स हैं हमारे वो ऐसी कंट्रीज़ को विज़िट कर रहे हैं. इनफैक्ट कल ही मेरे पास एक प्रेस रिलीज आई थी जो हमने अपने वेबसाइट पर भी डाला है कि एक मंत्री हमारे तिमोर लेस्ते गए थे. तो ये उसी का जो है उसी एंगेजमेंट का पार्ट है. स्मिता
एनी अपडेट एज फार एज द 39th इंडियन इन इराक हुज डीएनए
श्रीधर
सो यू जस्ट मेंशनड द टेलीफोनिक कॉन्वर्सेशन बिटवीन पीएम मोदी एंड प्रेसिडेंट पुतिन यस्टरडे. You know, Britain is interested in naming Russia in the common Chogum at Chogum, which India is opposing. So, in the light of this, could you just let us know whether this issue is being discussed? If not, I mean, at that level so far, or at other levels, has Russia sought any? Has Russia sought to explain its position to India, or just to keep it informed about what's happening?
Sridhar, there are two issues involved. On one, of course, is on the telephonic conversation between PM and President Putin. I have already shared that beyond what has been put out by Kremlin, I don't have much information. But on the incident itself, I would like to give a response, and I would like to read this out, that India is against the use of chemical weapons anywhere, at any time, by anybody, under any circumstances. We hope that this issue is resolved in accordance with the provisions of the Chemical Weapons Convention so as to reach evidence-based conclusions. India, as all other countries, awaits the outcome of the investigation.
So I had also asked you about this issue of a reported move by Britain to name Russia at Chogum, which India is.
We will have a briefing after this. I think this question can be addressed to the Joint Secretary UNP, who is dealing with Chogum.
Sir, 3 days pehle Peshawar mein lakh se zyada pashtunon ne प्रदर्शन किया और उन्होंने स्वतंत्रता की मांग की और ये भी इंटरनेशनल कम्युनिटी से मांग की कि फाटा में जो वॉर क्राइम्स हो रही हैं उसमें उनका दखल होना चाहिए. क्या भारत के पास कोई इस मांग को लेकर प्रतिक्रिया है?
नहीं, देखिए डायरेक्ट प्रतिक्रिया तो नहीं है इस पर, हमने कोई बयान भी जारी नहीं किया है, लेकिन हमने पहले भी कहा है कि जो पाकिस्तान में जो ग्रुप्स हैं, जो एथनिक माइनॉरिटीज़ हैं, वो पाकिस्तान का की लाइबिलिटी बनती है, वो रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी बनती है कि जो उनके वॉइसेस हैं उनका रिप्रेजेंटेशन होना चाहिए उनके डिसीजन मेकिंग में, और वही पोजीशन मैं आज दोहराना चाहता हूँ.
सर, इंटरनेशनल कोर्ट ऑफ जस्टिस में कुलभूषण जाधव केस की सुनवाई पे 13 तारीख को कुछ फर्दर एक्शन होना था, भारत के जो मेमोरेंडम भारत ने दिया था, तो उस पर क्या होना है, क्या अपडेट आप दे सकते हैं उस मामले में, क्या हो रहा है?
कुलभूषण जाधव केस में जैसा आप लोगों को पता है कि जो सबमिशंस होने थे वो दोनों तरफ से हो गए हैं. हमारी तरफ से सबमिशन हुआ, उसके बाद पाकिस्तान की तरफ से जो था उनकी तरफ से भी हुआ. अब ये डिसीजन इंटरनेशनल कोर्ट ऑफ जस्टिस को लेना है कि आगे फ्यूचर जो है वो क्या होना है. उसमें आर दे गोइंग टू आस्क फॉर फर्दर सबमिशंस बाय द टू साइड्स, और आर वी नाउ मूविंग टुवर्ड्स अ डिसीजन मेकिंग प्रोसेस. सो दैट इज समथिंग विच द इंटरनेशनल कोर्ट ऑफ जस्टिस हैज टू डिसाइड. मधुरेंद्र.
सर, सर सीरियन क्राइसिस को देखते हुए यूएन ने एक बैठक बुलाई है जो अमेरिका की तरफ से अटैक का थ्रेट दिया गया है. दूसरी तरफ ये देखा जा रहा है कि यूके ने भी एक मीटिंग जो है वो कंडक्ट करने जा रहा है, मतलब थेरेसा जो है वो करने जा रही है खासतौर पर अपने मंत्रियों के साथ कि क्या प्रोबेबल एक्शंस लिए जाएं. तो ये देखा जा रहा है कि सीरिया में एक तरफ से फ्रंट जो है अमेरिका का है, दूसरी तरफ से रूस का है, यूके भी फ्रंट खोल रहा है. हमारा क्या ओवरऑल स्टैंड सीरिया को लेकर?
हमारा तो हमने जो स्टैंड था वो हमने आपको पहले भी हमने बताया हुआ है. और जो सीरियन जो इशू है उसकी जो पोजीशन है, मैं आपको इसमें देखता हूँ अगर मेरे पास है. हमने जो इस फोरम से शेयर किया है दैट इंडिया रीअफर्म्स द प्राइमेसी ऑफ द यूएन लेड जेनीवा प्रोसेस एंड वी हैव कॉल्ड फॉर फुल सपोर्ट फॉर द इंट्रा सीरियन टॉक्स with a view to promoting a political solution in Syria. So ये हमने पहले भी statement issue किया है और इसको अगर आप जो भी मैंने statement दिया on the chemical weapon this thing उसके साथ जोड़ के देखें तो picture जो है ना पूरी हो जाती है. If there are no other questions then we conclude this weekly briefing. Mr. She will be traveling to Mongolia. First, she will go to China for the SEO ministerial meeting, and from there, she will be traveling to Mongolia for foreign minister level talks. Dates, she is leaving on 21st, so 22nd and 23rd will be in China, and then 24th and 25th will be in Mongolia. Thank you so much. I'll be back soon with the joint secretaries to brief you all on Prime Minister's visit to Sweden and UK. afternoon once again. I have a panel of joint secretaries who will brief us on Prime Minister's visit to Sweden and the United Kingdom from 16th to 21st. Basically, there are four components to the visit. The visit to Sweden has two components, the bilateral part, the bilateral component, and there is also the India-Nordic summit, which is taking place, the first India-Nordic summit. And then in the UK, again, there is a bilateral component, the bilateral visit, which will be followed by Prime Minister's presence at the Chogham summit. I have with me Joint Secretary Central Europe, Subhabrat Bhattacharji, Joint Secretary United UNP, United Nations Political, Rudrin Tandon, and JS Europe West, Nagaraj Naidu, to brief us on different aspects of the visit. We will start chronologically. We will start with Sweden, the bilateral component, as well as the India-Nordic summit. And then we will move on to the bilateral visit of Prime Minister to UK, and finally to the Chogham summit. Subhabrat, the floor is yours.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thanks for joining the media briefing. On the invitation of Swedish Prime Minister Stefan Löfven, Prime Minister of India will undertake his first visit to Sweden on 16 to 17 April 2018. During the visit, Prime Minister will have a number of bilateral meetings in Sweden. Additionally, India and Sweden will co-host an India-Nordic summit that will be attended by all other Nordic Prime Ministers. Nordic region includes five countries, namely Denmark, Finland, Iceland, Sweden, and Norway. Prime Minister will have bilateral meetings with four other Nordic Prime Ministers as well. Coming first to the bilateral part. Prime Minister will arrive at Stockholm on Monday, 16 April evening. There is no official program on that day. Next day, on Tuesday, 17 April, Prime Minister will have a number of meetings. He will have an audience with His Majesty, the King of Sweden, and a meeting with Swedish PM, who will host a lunch for our Prime Minister. Prime Minister, along with Swedish Prime Minister, will attend a roundtable meeting with Swedish CEOs. Both PMs will address the CEOs. In the evening, Prime Minister will meet the vibrant Indian community in Sweden before his departure for London. The visit to Sweden gains significance for a number of reasons. This will be a visit to Sweden by Indian Prime Minister after 3 decades, the last one being by Indian Prime Minister in 1988. India and Sweden have close ties and share common views on many global issues. Sweden is a valuable partner in our development and investment promotion initiatives. In the recent past, Honorable Ashtapatiji went to Sweden on the first ever state visit in 2015. Swedish PM Löfven visited India in February 2016 and participated in the Make in India Week in Mumbai along with a strong business delegation. PM Löfven takes keen interest in building strong economic ties with India. In October 2017, he participated in Make in India Sweden 2017, an event organized in Stockholm. Sweden's investment in India has crossed a timeline of 115 years. Ericsson has been here in India since 1903. So Swedish companies like Ericsson, Volvo, ABB, Tetra Pak, IKEA, H&M are some well-known names in India. There are over 170 Swedish companies that have invested US$1.4 billion since 2000. Indian companies are not lagging behind. Nearly 70 Indian companies have established their presence in Sweden. India-Sweden annual bilateral trade stands at around US$1.8 billion. Sweden is home to more than 20,000 members of Indian diaspora as well, including around 2,000 Indian students studying in various institutions. On the same day, on 17 April, Swedish PM and our Prime Minister will host an India-Nordic summit. The summit is entitled India-Nordic Summit, Shared Values, Mutual Prosperity, and scheduled to be attended by all Nordic Prime Ministers. India has substantial economic ties with Nordic countries, annual India-Nordic trade, that means India's trade with all five Nordic countries, is about $5.3 billion. The cumulative Nordic FDI into India has been $2.5 billion. The Nordic region represents a prosperous society with high incomes and a strong focus on quality and innovation. They rank high in Human Development Index. Three Nordic countries, namely Denmark, Sweden, and Finland, are members of the European Union. The other two, Norway and Iceland, are members of the four-country bloc, European Free Trade Association, known as EFTA. For India, Nordic countries are potential source for clean technology, environmental solution, port modernization, cold chain, skill development, innovation, etc. They could be our ideal partner for many flagship programs. Swedish and Finnish Prime Minister participated in Make in India Week in Mumbai in February 2016. Other than that, Smart City, Clean Ganga, Swachh Bharat, Skill India are some of the other flagship programs to which Nordic countries can contribute significantly. On the other hand, India has a large market and a vast pool of talent and skills. India is a potential market for Nordic technologies and a capable supplier of goods and services for Nordic population. These complementarities and the unique strength of India and the Nordic countries have attracted entrepreneurs from both sides. Given the similarities in characteristics and the ease of mobility across Nordics, it is also important to look at all Nordic countries as a region and not separately at five different entities. Taking note of the synergy existing between India and Nordic countries, we intend to develop a pan-Nordic view of India's ties with the Nordic region. Exchange of high-level visits, especially from India to Nordic countries at Prime Minister level, have been few. Standalone bilateral visits by Prime Minister of India have only been to Sweden in 1988 and to Denmark in 2009. Additionally, in 2006, our Prime Minister visited Finland for India-EU summit. Thus, the current visit also serves the purpose of high-level exchange between our Prime Minister and the Prime Minister of all five Nordic countries. As I said earlier, apart from meeting all Nordic Prime Ministers together in the summit, our Prime Minister will have separate bilateral meetings with each of the Nordic Prime Ministers. Thank you.
Thank you. Nagaraj, over to you.
Good afternoon, everyone. India and UK, we have a very modern partnership, and which is bound by historical ties. We've established strategic ties in the year 2004. This is one of the visits that we are looking forward to. We had a series of visits from the UK side to India. If you look at when David Cameron was the Prime Minister, he visited India three times. We had Prime Minister visiting UK in November 2015, and we have Theresa May having her first visit outside the EU to India in November 2016. So you can see that the high-level visits have been at a very frequent pace. Looking at the overall engagement, this is an old relationship and which is matured. We have a number of ongoing institutional mechanisms in place. On the finance side, where we get to meet at the finance minister's level. On the trade and economic side, where there is a regular interaction between the trade ministers, we have dialogues at the level of the National Security Advisor. We have an ongoing cyber dialogue. We have a dialogue at the policy planning level. And we have the defense secretaries get to meet very frequently. We also have a dialogue at the Home Secretary level. We have a very rich science and technology engagement, which this particular visit will really look at strengthening at. So the technology will be an underlying theme of this visit. If you look at the way we've engaged with the UK on the trade and economic side, it's a rich economic engagement. Our bilateral trade is at about $13 billion. Our services trade, which is also very strong, is about $7.2 billion. If any of you didn't know, we are also a very large investor in the UK. As a matter of fact, we are the fourth largest investor in the United Kingdom, and we are the second largest job creator. So we've created over 110,000 jobs. So that is very significant. If you look at the UK in India, among the G20 countries, they are the largest investor. From 2000 to 2017, the UK has invested about $25 billion. It is the fourth largest investor in this country. So economic-wise, technology-wise, we are seeing a lot of ongoing cooperation with the UK. This particular visit, there are two themes that you could look at. One theme is called as what we are trying to call it as a living bridge, meaning all people from all walks of life in both India and in the UK have contributed to the strengthening of this engagement. So Prime Minister, this visit will be meeting scientists, artists, scholars from across all walks, all spheres of activity. And our engagements are such that we will introduce these ongoing connections and place this relationship and encourage the youth or the next generation to an even vibrant engagement going forward. So what you will be seeing in this visit is something called as the living bridge that we will be talking about. The second one will be a lot of tech focus. Tech focus is because we are looking at the 21st century. We are looking at new areas of engagement between the two countries, whether it's big data, whether it's artificial intelligence, whether it is healthcare, whether it is the concept of digitization and how do we apply it to various spheres of activity, whether it's healthcare, where we see a lot of partnerships going on. So I think these two elements will be the highlight of the bilateral visit, the living bridge and the tech partnership. Are we going through the program as such? Okay. To give you a very brief idea, Prime Minister is arriving into the UK in the night of 17th. The bilateral visit is a day long, which will happen on the 18th. We will have the bilateral meeting in the morning at about 9 to 10, after which the engagement will be with the Prince of Wales. We will be visiting something called the Science Museum, where there is an ongoing exhibition, which is the 5,000 years of Indian science and innovation, all the contributions made by India in the field of science and innovation will be displayed. And at various points, we will have Indians or British origin Indians or Britishers who have contributed to certain areas of activity, and Prime Minister will get introduced to each one of them. So that will be part of the morning program at the Science Museum. We'll also be launching the Ayurvedic Center of Excellence that the All India Institute of Ayurveda is going to sign an MOU with the College of Medicine in the UK. So that will be another program. In the afternoon, there is a venue called the Crick Institute, where again Prime Minister and Prime Minister Theresa May will be having a series of events at this particular venue. We will be meeting Indian scientists who are working on cancer research, who are working on malaria and other tropical diseases. We'll have the CEOs Forum, where we will meet CEOs of both countries. Apart from that, we are looking at announcing the India-UK Tech Alliance, which will comprise of young CEOs from both countries who have done exceptionally well in the tech space. We'll also be meeting a few young Indian innovators who have won awards and who have also received funding from the UK side to, these are startups to expand their activities. So the afternoon bit will be meeting scientists, CEOs, young tech entrepreneurs, clean, the Clean Ganga. We are looking at something on the skill side. As I told you, we are looking at announcing something in the tech space. There is an MOU that we are looking with NASSCOM and Innovate UK. We are also looking at an MOU between Niti Aayog and its counterpart in the UK, again in the area of innovation. So all put together, maybe we're looking at about 10 to 12 deliverables and a joint statement. So I would leave it at that. Thanks.
Thank you, Nagaraj. And now, finally, to JSUNP, who will brief us on India's participation at the Commonwealth Summit.
Thank you. So after the bilateral segment that we'll get over on the 18th, the Prime Minister will participate in the Commonwealth Heads of Government meeting on the 19th and the 20th of April. This year, it is the United Kingdom that's hosting the CHOGAM Summit because it is taking charge as the chair in office for the next 2 years from Malta. The summit, like all summits, is organized around two segments. There is the executive session, which is the formal part of the summit. It's a structured agenda, and the interventions and are around the table. This is the formal part of the summit. This is followed on the 20th by the retreat. The retreat is an opportunity for Commonwealth heads of government to discuss what they choose to discuss. This is usually done in an informal setting. There is no preset agenda. So quite frankly, we don't have any particular idea of what exactly will be discussed in the retreat. The summit is formally structured around the theme, Our Common Future, and this underlies the sentiment that exists in the Commonwealth grouping that we are increasingly a tightly networked world who either prospers together or suffers together. And therefore, it is very important to work out activities for collective action. That would broadly summarize the CHOGAM Summit and PM's participation in it. A brief word about India's approach to the Commonwealth. In the multilateral space, for us, the Commonwealth is a very unique multilateral grouping. It comprises of a very diverse set of 53 countries, ranging from small island developing states to some of the most advanced industrialized countries of the world. And they all come together because of their shared commitment to democracy, law and peace and justice, and the promotion of rights, citizens' rights. So it's in the multilateral space, this is a very unique body because there are very few multilateral bodies that are so explicitly organized such enlightened humanist principles. However, the Commonwealth has over the years also acquired a niche position in the development space of the international system. It has a very strong international voice, particularly on developing country issues, and particularly the developing issues that impact small states and small island states in the Pacific, in the Caribbean, in the Indian Ocean. Over the years, it has also acquired some capacity to render assistance to these countries. And it is this dimension of the Commonwealth, its focus and specialization on the development issues that impact small island states, small states, that is of particular interest to India because, as you know, these are countries distributed and located in the Pacific, in the Indian Ocean, in the Caribbean, in Africa, in Latin America, with whom we have very close ties since the time we are independent and, of course, in some cases, historical ties predating our independence. That pretty much summarizes what I have to say. Thank you.
Now the floor is open to questions. Siddhant, and then Madhurendra. If you could also introduce yourself for the benefit of the joint secretaries.
Sam Siddhant from Vion. So my question is on the India-Nordic summit. What's the idea of having this summit? And of course, who proposed this idea? And what are the deliverables we are expecting from this summit?
As I mentioned when I did my briefing, that we felt the need to look at the Nordics as a region. These are five different countries, but they're much integrated. The easiness of movement, the mobility within the countries, not only movement of people, movement of capital, movement of ideas, movement of technologies, and similarity between them, helps us to look at the whole region as one block. So the idea of having a India-Nordic summit is primarily, you know, driven by that view of ours. This is, of course, first time we are doing an India-Nordic summit. The theme, as I said, that is called India-Nordic Summit, Shared Values, Mutual Prosperity. So we are looking largely at the economic issues, how we can make progress on that. And this will be an occasion and opportunity for the six heads of government to meet and share ideas, express their views. So definitely something more will come out of it. There's much we can do about India-Nordic region, as I mentioned. I don't want to clutter my response with a lot of data. But no such decision has been taken yet. Let's make the very first step and see how the dignitaries, the leaders meet and what the plan next. So I won't like to speculate on that.
Madhurendra.
मैं मधुरेंद्र न्यूज़ नेशन चैनल से मेरा सवाल चोगम समिट को लेकर है मौजूदा परिप्रेक्ष्य में ये देखा जा रहा है कि यूके और रसिया के बीच का संबंध जो है वो बेहद निचले स्तर पर है और जाहिर तौर पर दोनों का रिप्ट जो है वो सबके सामने है केमिकल वीपन का यूज जो है वो भी सीरिया में हुआ है ऐसा माना जा रहा है तो चोगम समिट के दौरान अगर यूके की तरफ से रसिया के खिलाफ कोई सैंक्शन आता है या फिर कोई ऐसा प्रस्ताव आता है तो भारत का स्टैंड क्या होगा खास तौर पे क्योंकि हमारा संबंध यूके और रसिया दोनों से ही बेहतर रहे हैं
मैं अंग्रेजी में जवाब दूंगा आई डोंट थिंक वी शुड स्पेकुलेट व्हाट अनदर कॉमनवेल्थ कंट्री इज लाइकली टू डू और नॉट डू आई एम अवेयर ऑफ द प्रेस आर्टिकल दैट अपीयर्ड टुडे बट क्वाइट फ्रैंकली दिस वुडंट बी द राइट प्लेस फॉर मी टू स्पेकुलेट एज टू व्हाट मे हैपन इफ समथिंग डज हैपन So I think that should do the.
Smita.
Hi, Smita Sharma from the Tribune. My question is to Rudrendra. You know, considering that the last two times India boycotted the Chogum summit for different reasons, what is it really that you're hoping this time that the Prime Minister is able to take to the table from an Indian perspective? And, you know, for Maldives that had walked out of Chogam, is that issue going to come in any form? Is that something that India has discussed? Because if you say that the organization stands for democracy and justice, it's not really reflected there as far as the Indian reaction so far is concerned.
Thank you very much. So insofar as what we hope to gain by PM's participation, I think you need to situate our engagement with the Commonwealth in the broader perspective of our multilateral effort around the world. You would have noted that India has been gradually stepping up the entire range of its multilateral engagements. The most obvious manifestation of that is, of course, the United Nations. But we are also stepping up in the SEO. We are also stepping up in the ASEAN. And you should see our engagement in the Commonwealth within the framework of that broader perspective. We hope that we can use Prime Minister's participation in the Chogam as an opportunity to explore the manner in which we can step up our engagement with the Commonwealth. As I told you, the Commonwealth has this speciality of looking after the interests, of advocating the interests of small states, small island, developing states. This is a category of country in the international system that is of particular interest to India, given our close ties with them, and of course our historical links with them. Insofar as Maldives is concerned, of course, it is regretful that, I mean, as a member of the Commonwealth, I can tell you from the preparatory phase, there is a general sentiment that you shouldn't lose members in a grouping. But beyond that, I have nothing to add for Maldives.
We will take two questions together now, Suhasini and Akhileshi.
Do we, Suhasini Heather from the Hindu, do we have an idea yet of the Prime Minister's bilateral meetings during the Commonwealth Summit? In particular, of course, has there been any request from the Pakistani side or from our side for a meeting between Prime Minister Abbasi and Prime Minister Modi?
Sir, when Prime Minister is going to Sweden, there was a very famous gun in Sweden that is called Bofors. Is there any talk about Bofors or any future defense cooperation? And my question to Mr. Tandon, that what we were hearing that India may figure as a central part of Chogam in the future. So has there been any such agenda that India will be one of the key players of Chogam in the future?
Insofar as the possible bilateral meetings on the margins of the Chogam, from the first reading of the scheduling, it's a very packed summit. So this is, if at all there will be bilateral meetings, it will be probably on the first date. But even that first day is completely packed. So at this juncture, we really don't have an idea of any of the bilateral meetings of Prime Minister. We do, of course, look at this as an opportunity to interact with the heads of government of small states, small island states. So prima facie, I think that would be the emphasis of our interaction because this is the most appropriate place to do so.
Yeah, on the Sweden part, yes, India gives focus on strengthening its defense capability, and Sweden has some strength in that. But beyond that, I cannot speculate whether any particular issue will be discussed between the two prime ministers.
Parikshit and Pranay.
Yeah. Mr. Naidu, I'm Parikshit from Republic TV. So my question is also about economic offenders. On the sidelines of G20, Prime Minister Modi and Theresa May had spoken about the return of economic offenders, and there was a tweet also which had been put out by the Ministry of External Affairs. So is this going to figure prominently in talks, and are we going to discuss ways on how we can expedite the return of offenders like Vijay Mallya? And Mr. Bhattacharya, my question about Saab and the Gripen D, this is a time when we're looking for fighter aircrafts. So defense, naturally, would it be a big component of the talks between India and Sweden? And number two, will there be any kind of engagement or dialogue or some sort of meetings with the CEOs of these companies, especially like Saab?
Before I pass it on to Pranay, let me remind you of a very old rule which still exists, which is one question per person so that we can accommodate as many people as possible. Pranay.
This is Pranay Upadhyay from ABP News. Recently, Commonwealth Secretary General Patricia Scotland said, and she indicated that one of the agenda items for the Chogam is the leadership reform for the Chogam as an organization. So does India support the idea to make presidency of Chogam more equitable, more representative, and making democratically elected leaders as president of Chogam?
There is no president of Chogam. There is a head of the Chogam, Her Majesty the Queen, not the British Crown. Her Majesty the Queen is the head of the Commonwealth. Decisions regarding who will be the head of the Commonwealth is taken only by the Commonwealth heads of government meeting, by the heads of government. They are the only people who are empowered to decide who would be the head of the Commonwealth. But having said that, I must tell you that there is great admiration for what the service that Her Majesty the Queen has rendered the Commonwealth. We must not forget that it was under her headship that the Commonwealth has undergone this remarkable transformation from what it was in the past to a multilateral organization that speaks for the smallest states in the international system. So there is no precedent. And the heads always decide, the heads of government always decide who the head will be.
Nagraj. On the question of economic offenders, let me be very clear that the agenda includes all issues. All issues will be taken up by both sides. At the same time, the issue of economic offenders is more of the domain of the Ministry of Home Affairs, and there are two ongoing dialogues, one at the level of the Home Secretary and one at the level of the Minister. And Minister Rijiju was in UK just in January this year, and this issue was discussed at great detail. And the legal process in its on its way, there are lawyers on both sides. This case is being addressed. All extradition cases are being dealt with. At the same time, if this issue comes up, surely, we will discuss it at great length. Thanks.
Brahm Prakash and Tripti.
I have one question left.
Achha, sorry.
On the issue of Saab and Gripen, yes, Saab has shown serious interest. They have shown serious interest in manufacturing Gripen fighter aircraft in India under Make in India program. I'm aware of that. This is primarily an issue dealt with by Ministry of Defense, but you would have seen from the media reports that Ministry of Defense is now asking for the RFI, request for information, from the prospective bidders who wants to respond to that. So I'm sure Saab qualifies for that. But beyond that, I do not have the other details. And as for PM's interaction with the CEOs, as I mentioned, there will be one interaction, a round table, in which both Indian PM and Swedish PM will participate in the round table. Both PMs will address the gathering, and some of the CEOs from the gathering, select ones, will get to speak very briefly, put across their viewpoint. That's the broad idea. But the list of the CEOs I do not have. With the Swedish side, our Department of Industry and Policy and Promotion will work out the list. But in any case, the roundtable does not envisage any one-to-one meeting with any CEOs and our Prime Minister. It's a general roundtable. Thank you.
We will take the last round of questions. Brahm Prakash, Tripti, anybody else? Sridhar.
Sir, Brahm Prakash Dave, Z News. Se. Mera sawal ye hai ki Chogam ke manch par kya Bharat टेररिज्म का मुद्दा भी उठाएगा, पाकिस्तानी सपोर्टेड जो आतंक का मुद्दा है वो भी उठाएगा, और जो चोगम में जो सभी कंट्री के हेड्स से बायलेटरल मीटिंग है, क्या बायलेटरल मीटिंग में भी ये मुद्दा उठेगा? और एक साथ में ही जुड़ा, इसी से जुड़ा ये सवाल है कि आपने कहा कि पैक्ड है उस दिन पीएम का शेड्यूल, पाकिस्तान के पीएम के साथ कोई प्री प्लान नहीं है, तो क्या रास्ता आगे खुला है, ऑप्शन क्या मुलाकात हो सकती है?
तृप्ति.
With national interests always on top of his mind, is the Prime Minister likely to bring up the issue of Kohinoor in the bilateral meetings?
Final question to Sridhar.
So what's the progress on this issue of taking back illegal immigrants from the UK?
On terrorism, the fact that we need, the international community needs to get together to combat terrorism is an important part of our overall multilateral diplomacy. But you must remember that we use different platforms for different purposes. So tackling the issue of the global counterterrorism effort is best done at the United Nations. The Commonwealth, as I told you, focuses on developing country problems. And keeping that focus is important, so it wouldn't be appropriate. Having said that, a lot of social work, society-related work is done within the Commonwealth. So activities that help in preventing violent extremism and that whole series of activities that are contemplated by member states, that is the focus in this Commonwealth. This is a standard thing, preventing violent extremism using education, using social groups, community elders intervening. These are activities that are promoted within the Commonwealth. That's true.
Yeah, your question has been answered? Okay.
See, the returns issue is very important, and you would note that we now have a national portal which enables identification of nationality. So that is already in place, and we've discussed this with the UK side. And we have an arrangement in place which ensures that as and when somebody is identified to be illegal and his status has been also been certified by the Indian side, there is a way that we take that person back. So this is already in place, and the agreement that we are looking at is a continuation of what we had agreed to before. So it ended in 2014, but even though it ended in 2014, since 2014 to now, it is still being implemented because the process is in place. So essentially, if anybody is identified and his identification is proved that he's Indian, and so we have a procedure and a proper procedure in place to take that individual back.
So we will renew it.
We are looking at, we are looking at renewal. Renewal is one, but there is also new elements that usually keep getting added to any agreement. So it will be a little updated version. Now, the Kohinoor issue is, this issue is well known. It's answered in the parliament many times. Our position as such remains the same. You can look at the most updated parliamentary question. Our response is available even on the MEA website. It's an issue of Ministry of Culture. And if we have somebody coming back to us asking us what is the status, we will definitely go back to the UKF to it. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you, Joint Secretaries, and thank you all for joining. With this, we conclude this special press briefing. Thank you very much.